Right. Now, good afternoon, everybody. I welcome you all to this Wednesday lecture series. I'm happy that many of you have found time to take part in this lecture series. So today, we'll continue with where we had left last week, that is literature and mythology. I request all of you to join before 3:05 or 3:10 so that I can concentrate on my presentation. All right. So in the last class, we saw mythos, the concept of mythos, myth, mythology, mythopoeic, and so on. Then we also discussed some of the theorists, especially Carl Jung and also Northrop Frye. So my interest is not in myth criticism, rather I'm interested in mythology, especially Greek mythology and Roman mythology, which had a lasting influence on the writing of literature down the centuries. A good knowledge of literature, especially literature related to mythology, helps us to understand literature better. In order to understand Indian writing in English or Indian literature or any regional literature from India, we need to have at least some knowledge of the myths that are prevalent in this country. That also I explained to you in the last class. And again, I told you, myth is a thought and myth is literature. So we have to look into myth in literature and myth as literature. So very often we talk of grand narratives, and most of these grand narratives are nothing but stories related to mythology. These are all grand stories. Grand stories. Then I also made this distinction between a myth and a legend. I went on to tell you how a legend is different from a myth. And a legend is always presented as history, but it's unlikely to be true. So that's how we treat legend. Then again, I explained the concept of euphemerism in the last class. That is the theory of historic origins of mythology. That this theory holds that mythology has its origins in history, and the heroes are deified in the past and they have been exalted to the level of gods. So I told you about this euhemeristic approach towards myth. Then also I went on to explain the early Greek myths. So how, especially I told you about Theogony, that is the history of gods, and also cosmogony, that is the history of universe. Again, I explained towards the end how, in order to explain the natural phenomena or phenomena occurring in nature, we need to have stories. So stories are related to change in seasons, stories related to the cycle of life, stories related to our life, our love, our human emotions, our human behavior. We need certain stories. And finally, we have discovered how the Greek gods themselves were like humans. They had all the qualities of human beings. They were jealous, they were full of greed, they would commit murder, they would commit all sorts of crimes. So the gods were no different from ordinary humans. Then again, I told you about the place of importance given to Zeus. And again, I went on to explain how Zeus had multiple affairs. He had a relationship with women, that is humans, and also he had a relationship with goddesses. As a result, he had many children. And I also gave you the list of children that he had fathered. So Zeus is regarded as God the Father. And finally, I told you how he has chosen Mount Olympus as the abode, not only for Zeus, but also for another 11 gods. In all, 12 different gods and goddesses, they occupy Mount Olympus. And this is a place from where he rules. Then again, I told you about the Titans who are pushed to the abyss and how the relationship between the divine and the human has become very narrow. I went on to tell you there was a lot of border crossing between the life of the mortals and the immortals, the life of the divine and the human, and the life of people on earth and life of people who live in an abode like Mount Olympus or beyond the human realm. This week, we will continue. And I'd like to introduce one or two theorists who had certain things to say about myths. So today, I want to focus your attention on one such critic. His name is Leslie Fiedler. Now, Leslie Fiedler argues how Plato's ancient quarrel between poetry and philosophy is really a dispute between logos and mythos. Say logos, it is language. If you remember Derrida, he is on record saying that it is logocentric. Everything hinges on language, the human language. It doesn't matter which language you speak. So now, according to him, this logos and mythos. Logos is the language of philosophy, whereas mythos is the language of poetry. Of course, you know, he banished the poets from his republic. So he has reasons to do so because this is a world full of rich imagination. To borrow Carl Jung's words, it is full of primordial images. So, now, given such primordial images and given the mythoi, that is to use Northrop Frye's term, he talks about mythoi, and especially he talks about the seasons and the generic narratives related to each season. Just to recollect, in the last class or in the last lecture, I told you how comedy is related to the season of spring and romance is related to the season of summer and tragedy is related to the season of autumn and irony and satire are related to the season of winter, which he calls mythoi. Okay, so now Leslie Fiedler, he appropriates Carl Jung's archetypes, that is the primordial images, and Benedetto Croce's intuitionism, that is the human intuition, to define myth. So what finds expression as myth is nothing but stories related to seasons, stories related to life cycle, stories related to human life in general, and also the natural phenomena. So, Fiedler says that literature comes into being only with the imposition of a signature. Now, a signature upon mythic materials, all the mythic materials that are available before us, they carry the human signature. And this signature he calls being the sum total of individuating factors in a work. So now we apply our signature, that is the persona whoever narrates the tale, whoever tells the tale, he leaves the signature on this mythic material. Okay, so then again I told you in the last class how these Greek mythologies, they had their origins in different cities. Saying the ancient Greeks had their own city-states, and each city had its own gods and goddesses. Later, when Christianity became the popular religion in Europe, every city had its own patron saints. Saints that would who would protect these cities. We'll talk about that a little later. So, Leslie Fiedler, he had an important contribution to make. And so did Roland Barthes. Now, Roland Barthes wrote a work titled Mythologies. Now, what does he say in his work, Mythologies? And he also wrote an essay titled Myth Today. Now, what does he say in this book, Mythologies, and in this Myth Today? He says, myth is a special type of speech. Myth is a special type of speech. Now, look at Leslie Fiedler. He says, mythos is the language of poetry. It is the language of poetry. And here, he says, Roland Barthes says, myth is not an object, idea, or concept, but it is a form of signification. We all know what signification is. It is a form of signification, according to Roland Barthes. So, and he says, everything can be turned into a myth. So, everything can be turned into a myth, though not everything is a myth. Anything you can turn into a myth. So, now this is Roland Barthes' idea. And he also goes on to say, myths are not universal. They are not universal. They are to be dealt with in their specificity. Every myth is specific. It may be related to a human emotion. It may be related to human behavior. It may be related to a natural phenomenon. So it is specific, and myths are not universal. Then he says, myths are constructed from material that has already been worked on. So we construct myth from or with the materials that have already been worked on. So myth itself becomes a kind of a second order or meta system. Now, this is according to Barthes. So, now keep all these things at the back of your mind as we talk more about mythology, and we'll continue our discussion on mythology and especially Greek myths. And again, kindly remember, as Carl Jung says, myths are part of our racial memory. They are part of our collective unconscious. So there is something called our private unconscious, which we integrate well with the collective unconscious, and there we have the myths available in the form of racial memory. Okay, so we'll continue today. Again, I'll tell you more about Greek mythology and about Greek writers, especially the ancient Greek writers like Homer who wrote Iliad and Odyssey, then Ovid who wrote his Metamorphoses, and Virgil who wrote his Aeneid. So now look at all these works. The characters drawn from Greek mythology, they find a ready representation in most of the, or in much of the poetry written by poets who came after the Renaissance. Even during the Renaissance, the writers borrowed material heavily from this Greek mythology. Look at Shakespeare. Shakespeare wrote something like Venus and Adonis, which is then Aprilia. And Christopher Marlowe wrote Hero and Leander, again from Greek mythology. Shakespeare too wrote this work, The Rape of Lucrece. This is again from Greek mythology. And look at writers, say, who came, who even translated works, say, Homer's Iliad and Odyssey, they were translated into English by George Chapman. So people kept on translating their works, and even in the 20th century we come across someone like Ted Hughes translating Ovid's Metamorphoses. So much of this Greek mythology after this Theogony and Cosmogony rests with one particular house, that is one particular family, that is called the House of Atreus. Now, this House of Atreus in Greek mythology is a very important one, and in Greek mythology, it is a royal family of Mycenae. And this Atreus, he was elected king by Mycenaean notables. And this ill-fated House of Atreus, it was really a favorite subject of ancient Greek writers, notably Homer, Aeschylus, Euripides, Sophocles, and Pindar. Now, they all recollect the misfortunes that befell the House of Atreus, and especially it is related to the behavior of Tantalus, king of Lydia. Now, this Tantalus was a martyr who had the privilege of even dining with gods. He was well received by God. He was accorded all the respect due to a god, and he dined with gods. But at one point, he offended the gods, and he was punished forever in Tartarus. Tartarus, you remember? That is the bottomless pit. Now, he had two sons. One was Talos. The other one, he had a son and a daughter, sorry. His son's name was Pelops, and his daughter's name was Neo. So we'll look into the story. Perhaps if you know this story, you can understand the stories of Homer and others. Now, he was king of Lydia, and he was son of Zeus, ruler of the gods. So once he invited the gods to come to his table, and they were all assembled there. And Tantalus, he wanted to test the qualities of God. The gods are said to be omnipotent, omniscient, right, and omnipresent. These three are thought of as supreme qualities of a god. That is, gods are omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. So he wanted to test their omniscience. So what he did, he killed his only son, Pelops, and boiled him in a cauldron and served them at the banquet. The gods soon, however, realized the nature of the food. So what was served to them? They got very angry, and they restored his son, Pelops, to life and devised a terrible punishment for Tantalus. So what the gods did, you should not rub the gods on the wrong side. You should not offend the gods. Tantalus went and offended the gods. So as a punishment, he was hung far away from a tree in Tartarus. And he was afflicted with thirst and hunger. And he was hanging from a tree. Under him was a pool of water. But whenever he tried to reach the water or the pool would sink from sight. Then above him, on top of the tree, it was laden with pears, apples, figs, ripe olives, and pomegranates. But whenever he tried to reach for them, the wind blew the branches away. So he was eternally condemned to hang on a tree without being able to satisfy his thirst and hunger. That's how the word tantalize has come to our English language. So the word tantalize means something that tempts you, but you cannot reach it. So the word tantalize is derived from this story. His son, Pelops, in Greek mythology, right, was rescued by gods when he was served as boiled flesh to the gods. And during the course of the meal, the goddess, especially Demeter, remember, Demeter is the Greek goddess of bounty, Greek goddess of earth, and Greek goddess of fertility of earth. So she was deeply distracted by the loss of her daughter Persephone. Saint Persephone had gone to the underworld. She was taken away by Hades. At that time, she happened to be there on this dining table, and she ate the shoulder of Pelops. So later, when Pelops was restored to life, his shoulder was replaced with one of ivory. So Pelops had this shoulder made of ivory. Right, that is the story of Pelops. He married one princess, Hippodamia, by winning a chariot race from her father, King Onomus of Pisa. So even here, there was trickery. So there was some kind of cunning exercised by the princess. She bribed the charioteer, Myrtilus, to remove the linchpins from Onomus' chariot. So what happened? Onomus' chariot, it collapsed during the race, and Pelops won the race, and he won the hand of Hippodamia. Later, Pelops, he quarreled with Myrtilus, and he hurled him into the sea. And before he drowned, the charioteer cursed Pelops. Though the curse had no effect on Pelops, it had its effect on his children. Now, this is the curse on the house of Atreus. So, now, Pelops, had a sister. Her name was Niobe. You must have come across this name, Niobe, in Greek mythology. She was the daughter of Tantalus and the queen of Thebes, and also sister of Pelops. Her husband, King Amphion, was a son of the god Zeus, and he was a great magician. Niobe, she was a very beautiful woman, and she bore King Amphion. She was a martyr. She bore him 6 handsome sons and 6 beautiful daughters. Although she was happy, Niobe exhibited the same arrogance toward the gods that her father had shown. Her father, Tantalus, he showed so much of arrogance, and he invoked the wrath of God. So she boasted of her superiority to the goddess Leto. Remember, Leto was the wife of Zeus, and who had 2 children, that is Apollo and Artemis. You know, Leto was a titan. So the god heard the appeal of Leto on Mount Olympus, and they resolved to punish Niobe. Because look at Niobe's arrogance. Her arrogance proved to be her undoing. Her proud taunting of Leto led to her fall. So Leto's children, Apollo, that is a god of prophecy and a master archer, and his sister Artemis, goddesses of the hunt, they fired their deadly arrows at Niobe's children, killing all of them. So all the 12 children perished. 6 of her handsome sons and 6 of her beautiful daughters, they were killed. Why? Because she chose to taunt Leto, and thereby she brought a curse on her head. So the grief-stricken Niobe was turned into a stone, and there was forever wet, the stone was wet with her tears. So you must have come across this English expression, Niobe-like. So anyone who suffers a terrible tragedy, you almost turn into a stone, absolutely any, without any emotion or movement in your body, but your eyes continue to shed tears. So Tantalus, his children, Pelops, and Niobe, and they, this house of Atreus, I told you the charioteer cursed Pelops, and Pelops had a son, his name was Atreus. So now the curse was on their home. Atreus' brother, his name was Thyestes, he seduced the wife of Atreus. Now look at them. These people are humans, and they behave like humans. He seduces another man's wife. In revenge, what Atreus did, he served the boiled flesh of 2 sons of Thyestes to the father at a banquet. Saying, Thyestes' third son, however, Aegisthus, he survived. But 2 of Thyestes' sons, they died. And Aegisthus, he killed Atreus to avenge this deed. And remember, Atreus had 2 sons. One was Agamemnon and Menelaus. Now, if you rack your brains, you will understand who these 2 were. These 2 were from Mycenae, and they were the most famous heroes of the Trojan War. It was the abduction of Menelaus' wife, Helen of Troy. So in the last lecture, I told you about the birth of Helen of Troy, how Zeus went and courted Leda in the form of a swan, and how Leda, a mortal, she gave birth to 4 children. Actually, she had 2 eggs, 4 children, and one of them was Helen, and Helen is an immortal. And Menelaus' wife was Helen, and she was kidnapped by Paris. I'll come to the story now a little later, but we'll finish this House of Atreus. So Agamemnon and Menelaus, and Menelaus' wife was Helen. At the end of the Trojan War, Menelaus and Helen were reconciled, and following many adventures, they returned to Sparta, and they lived happily. But whereas Agamemnon was killed on the day of his triumphant homecoming by his wife Clytemnestra and Aegisthus. During the absence of her husband, because Agamemnon was away in Troy for nearly 10 years fighting against the Trojans, Clytemnestra took a lover, and that was Aegisthus. Right. And the moment that Agamemnon returned, Clytemnestra and Aegisthus, they killed Agamemnon. Later, Agamemnon's death was avenged by his children, Electra and Orestes. This is another story. And Orestes was finally, right, the acquitted of all his blood guilt in the murder of his mother, though the Furies were after him. I told you about the Furies in the last class, remember? Whenever you commit murder or display excess of anger, the Furies come. And the Furies, they never stop till the murder is avenged. Actually, they take up the case to Areopagus in Athens. So, now I'll tell you something about Areopagus. Now, with the death of Agamemnon and Clytemnestra, the curse on the house of Atreus was finally lifted. Now, what is this Areopagus in Athens? Remember, in 1644, John Milton wrote this work, Areopagitica. That is, you place your case before the court. Say, when Milton wrote his Areopagitica, he was talking about free press. And also, he was questioning church's authority over human lives. Especially, he was discussing the idea of divorce in Christianity. So, there were so many things which were unthinkable in that age that were discussed by John Milton, who had the title of his work as Areopagitica. But you need to understand, what is this Areopagus? This court of law. See, the ancient Greeks had this court. It was there in the Acropolis in Athens, and they convened on the hill. This court was convened on the hill. Usually, it consisted of a council of nobles. They met in the open. The accuser and the accused stood on platforms cut from the rock. Now, we imitate this model in our court. You go to any court, you'll find two different, stands. On one of the stand, there stands the accused, and in the another one, the accuser stands. And the judge listens to them. In those days, they had a panel of judges, and they could call any government official to testify because the decisions of the court were final. So, there were these two great Athenian lawgivers. One was Draco, and the other one was Solon. And people say this itself was an imitation of the other Areopagus, where gods went and presented their cases. So, the Furies, they wanted to avenge the death of Clytemnestra, but somehow or other there was, it was like a bench. They were equally divided. As a result, Orestes was acquitted. Okay, so now we will look into this. Now come to Helen of Troy and the Homer's the Iliad. It all begins, Homer's Iliad starts in medias res with the story of Achilles. Now, you know, Helen of Troy, she had been kidnapped, and you know the story, how it happened. And I'll tell you the story later, but let me finish with the Iliad. Say, Achilles, it tells the story of Achilles, one of the greatest of the Greek warriors in the Trojan War. The next one was Odysseus or Ulysses. So now, who was this Achilles? He was the son of the sea nymphs Tethys and Pallas. See, there are too many names. You may not be able to remember all these names, but have some understanding. So, say, there are so many branching of tales, like we have in the Mahabharata. There are so many branching of tales in Mahabharata, innumerable characters. Likewise, the Greek mythology also, you come across so many such characters. So, now all the Greeks are assembled outside the city of Troy, and they have laid a siege to the city of Troy. This you can watch from the film Troy. I'm sure many of you must have watched the film Troy. And if you watch the film Troy, you can understand. And Achilles, remember, was a great hero. He had fought many battles, and during the 10-year siege of Troy also, he had taken part in many battles. And remember, Agamemnon was the commander-in-chief. And you had to take orders from Agamemnon. And so, during the war, Achilles had taken a young woman as a captive, that maiden by name, Briseis. Now, Agamemnon comes and claims she was his war booty. And takes the... And he takes the Right. So kindly switch off the mic and maintain silence. Thank you. Right. So now, during the, when he took this young maiden away, Achilles withdrew from the battle. So you know the story, how Achilles sulks in his tent, and the Trojans, they are emboldened by his absence because, you know, he has no death. So Achilles can fight and kill anyone. His presence in the battlefield means there will be a terrible loss of life to the enemies. So now when he withdraws, the Trojans are able to beat back the Greeks. Then when the Greeks are mauled by the Trojans, Patroclus, Achilles' friend and companion, he begs Achilles to lend him his armor. So he puts on the armor and he leads the Myrmidons into battle. So the Trojans mistake him for Achilles and they attack him with such ferocity, you know, Patroclus dies. And now the grief-stricken Achilles, he returns to the battlefield, and you know the story, how he slays Hector and he drags his body behind his chariot and he returns from the battlefield. So later in the night, King Priam of Troy, he visits the tent of Achilles and you know, begs him to release his son's body so that he can be given a very decent burial. You know, Achilles is deeply moved by the sight of the old man, Priam, king of Troy. He releases the dead body of Hector. Right. Then, you know the story, and how the Greeks enter, how they breached the walls of Troy by creating an artificial wooden horse, and how they enter during the middle of the night, and finally how they slaughter the Trojans. But Achilles perishes in the battle. He is wounded in the heel by Paris. Now, this story is told by Homer in his The Iliad. So understand this story. And of course, I'll just give you a flashback of the story of Helen of Troy. So Helen of Troy, how she landed in, though she was a Greek and the wife of Menelaus, how she was taken to Troy. It was all the working of Aphrodite. So, and the story begins saying, the 10-year conflict began when three goddesses, Hera, Athena, and Aphrodite, asked the Trojan prince Paris to choose the most beautiful among them. So, they all tried to influence his decision, and Paris chose Aphrodite as the most beautiful one because she had promised him the world's most beautiful woman. And who was the world's most beautiful woman? That was Helen of Troy. So Aphrodite, she took Paris and he set sail to Greece, where he was hospitably received by Helen and her husband Menelaus, king of Sparta. So now there, Helen fell under the influence of Aphrodite and allowed Paris to persuade her to elope with him. And he carried her off to Troy. Then you know the story, how Menelaus, he asked the fellow Greek chieftains, including Agamemnon and Ulysses and others, to help him to retrieve his wife. And you know the story of the battle. And during the battle, there was this one-to-one combat between Menelaus and Paris. So Menelaus was a very angry husband, and he was about to finish off Paris, but Aphrodite intervened, and somehow or other, creating a cloud, she helped Paris to escape. Right, you know the story, and finally the fall of Troy, and Menelaus was reunited with his wife. However, they incurred the displeasure of the gods, and they were driven by storms from shore to shore in the Mediterranean Sea, like it happened to Ulysses. So, finally, they reached Sparta, and they again started their marital life in royal splendor. They had one daughter, Hermione. Right, this is the story of Iliad. And the story of Odyssey is something different. While Ulysses returns to his kingdom, Ithaca, say, I'm not going to tell you the entire story. His wife's name is Penelope. You read this poem by Tennyson, Ulysses. It tells you, in brief, the story of Ulysses. Ulysses encounters many adventures. He also moves from one island to another island. And especially, if he crosses Scylla and Charybdis, then Ulysses and his men, they incur the wrath of Poseidon, sea god. Out of his 12 ships, 11 ships were destroyed. Ulysses escaped with a few men on board of his ship. Then they also listen to the song of the sirens, the enchantress, and how Ulysses asks himself to be tied to the mast of the ship, right? And he tells his crew not to be enchanted by the song of the siren and so on. See, His wife, Penelope, is a faithful wife, Ulysses' wife. So, when he returns home, he is reunited happily. But Clytemnestra of Sparta, she is not faithful to Agamemnon. And as a result, when Agamemnon returns with his war booty, that is Cassandra, sister of Priam and Hector, as his war booty, both of them were killed by Clytemnestra and Aegisthus. And Clytemnestra and Aegisthus, they cite the reason. Because before the Greeks set sail, there was this unusual calm and there was this storm. Now, Agamemnon gave his daughter Iphigenia as a sacrifice to the gods. And Clytemnestra's daughter Iphigenia perished as a human sacrifice. And Clytemnestra wanted to have vengeance. Now, look at all the stories. It is full of vengeance. It is full of greed, jealousy, all human qualities. The negative human qualities are the evil human qualities. They come to the fore in these mythological stories. I am not entering into the Mahabharata or the Ramayana, the stories. These stories are all too familiar to you. You know the trickery played by people in a card game, how, you know, the wife was insulted before the courtiers, right? So, now you know the story of Ramayana and how he was deprived of the throne. You know all these stories, human trickery and human cunning and human, some of those worst human qualities, they come to the fore, they result in brutal and very, very barbaric wars. Okay, now you should understand how the Romans appropriated the Greek mythology. The Romans came a little later. The Greeks were the forerunners. The Greeks were ruling the northern part of Mediterranean for a long time. Then the Romans came. The Romans became very powerful during the 2nd century and later. So, they borrowed these stories from Greek mythology and they gave them the Roman names. So, I have given you some of these equivalents, Roman equivalents, and the sphere of influence. For instance, Zeus is called Jupiter by the Romans. He is chief of God, or God of the sky. Poseidon is a brother of Zeus, we know. And he is the lord of the sea, that is clear, his sphere of influence. He is called Neptune by the Romans. Hades, underworld, again another brother of Zeus. Now Hades is called Pluto, that is, Pluto is the lord of the dead or underworld. Now Hestia in Greek mythology, goddess of the earth, and she is called Vesta. She remains unmarried. Vestal virgins and Vesta, that name. Right. Then Hera becomes Juno. That is, Hera happens to be the wife of Zeus. And also, Ares is god of war, that is Mars. Athena, a child of Zeus. But she came from the temple of God Zeus, Minerva, goddess of wisdom. See, all these human activities and all this, they need a story to sustain the human activity or the activity of gods. See, god of war, wars are waged by humans. We do not know much about the wars between gods, but the wars waged between humans, we know, and every time they wage a war, they invoke the blessings of war god. And remember, gods also take sides. They are not always, what we call without the favor. They always favor someone, right? It is not that they practice justice or equity. No. Gods have their own preferences. They take sides. They support someone. Or they indulge in some kind of trickery or in some kind of cunning. Okay. Now look at it. Aphrodite, deity. The Roman equivalent says Venus, and that is goddess of love and beauty. Hermes is called Mercury by the Romans. And again, this god is a messenger of gods, Hermes. Artemis, right? Known as Diana, goddess of the hunt, right? Then Apollo, just take a quick look at these names of gods and you try to remember them. Now Vulcan, that is Hephaestus. In the last lecture I told you, so how Hephaestus, he designed the abode of gods on Mount Olympus. He was god of smiths and weavers. And Demeter, you know, she was the goddess of the harvest. Her daughter is Persephone. She is the goddess of the underworld. Then Dionysus, that is Bacchus, god of wine, and so on. Just take a look at these few important gods, Greek gods, and their Roman equivalents. We'll move on. Why am I showing you this? Because I'm going to tell you something about the Roman mythology too. Now, in order to understand the Roman mythology, you have to understand the story of Aeneas, whose story is told by Virgil in his Aeneid. Say, in this story, right, now go back. So, now, in Roman mythology, he is the son of Anchises, a Trojan prince, and Venus, that is goddess of love. Okay, now this is the Roman name Venus, and what's the name of Venus in Greek? Aphrodite. So Aphrodite is the one who saves Paris, right, from Menelaus, also known as Venus. And look at her. Now, her son is Aeneas. Now, after the capture of Troy by the Greeks, Aeneas, he escaped from the fallen city with the help of his mother. He carried his aged father on his back, that is Anchises, a Trojan prince, and leading his little son by the hand, so he headed to the sea coast. During the flight, however, he lost his wife. So his wife was left behind. And a long, arduous, and adventure-filled voyage took Aeneas to different parts of Greece, to Thrace, Delos, Crete, and Sicily. And in Sicily, his father died. Then the goddess Juno. Now, who is Juno? That is the Greek goddess Hera. Hera happens to be the wife of Zeus. So, now Juno, she had always hated Aeneas and she wanted to prevent him from founding Rome. We do not know what she held against Aeneas, but she somehow or other wanted to prevent him from becoming the founder of Rome. She knew his destiny, so what she did, she tried to drown him in a violent storm. However, he and his crew, they escaped and they reached the African coast, where they were welcomed by the African queen, Dido. You learn the story of Dido because this story was told by Christopher Marlowe and others. That is Dido, the queen of Carthage, the beautiful queen of Carthage. She fell in love with Aeneas and she begged him to remain. But he refused and he set sail because his destiny beckoned him to Rome. Out of sheer despair, She killed herself. Dido killed herself. So this is the story of Aeneas, and the story continues. After several years of wandering, Aeneas reaches Italy and the mouth of River Tiber. There he is received by Latinus, that is king of Latium. So later we get the term Latin, which is used as an equivalent to Italy and Rome. So he becomes betrothed to Lavinia, the beautiful daughter of Latinus. But before he could marry her, the king of the Rutuli, a rejected suitor of Lavinia, he declares war against Aeneas and Latinus. However, both the parties agree, instead of going on an all-out war, let us decide between us. Whoever wins the hands of Lavinia. So, in this hand-to-hand mortal combat, Turnus is killed. He is slain by Aeneas, and Aeneas, after which, rules over Latium by marrying Lavinia. Thus, the Trojans and the Latins were brought together, and they were united, and they produced the Roman people. This is the story of the Romans. The Romans take pride of their historical heritage from Aeneas and the Trojan kings. So, some people believe this could have happened many centuries ago. People believe the Trojan War could have been fought during the 12th century BC. Say, when they made certain excavations and certain archaeological diggings in Turkey, they had come across palaces and how these palaces were destroyed by fire. So this could have been the greatest war fought between the Greeks and the Trojans, people say. So Aeneid, in his work, the Aeneid, Virgil tells the story in detail. And this story ends with the death of Turnus, right, who claims the hand of Lavinia, and how Aeneas establishes the Roman Empire. Okay, now that is another writer, Sophocles. So I want you to be familiar with all these mythological characters and ancient Greek and Roman writers, so that you could understand English literature as well. Because I'm not saying anything that is away from literature, because myth itself is literature. They are grand narratives, great stories. Okay, when Sophocles wrote his work, especially, he wrote the three plays, Oedipus, where he tells the story of Oedipus and his children. So, you know the story of Oedipus. In Greek mythology, he is the king of Thebes. Actually, he was the son of Laius and Jocasta, king and queen of Thebes. So, King Laius was warned by the oracle that one day his son would kill him. So, fearing his own son, Laius bound the feet of his newborn child and left him to die on a lonely mountain. But Oedipus was rescued by a shepherd, and this shepherd had given him to Polybus, king of Corinth, who was childless. So, and they named the child Oedipus Swollen Foot and raised him as their own child, Polybus and his wife. And for a long time, Oedipus did not know that he was adopted. But when an oracle proclaimed that he would kill his father, he left Corinth thinking that Polybus was his real father. But, and he started wandering. He did not want to commit parricide and patricide. Parricide or regicide. The main regicide means killing a king, and patricide means killing one's father. He wanted to save himself, but unfortunately, the fate, he was fated to kill his own father. So, in the course of his wanderings, he met Laius, thinking that he was a robber, and he killed his own father, and thus unwittingly he fulfilled the prophecy. Then he wandered, and finally, lonely and homeless, he arrived at Thebes. Now, by this time, the city of Thebes was beset by a dreadful monster called the Sphinx. Now, there is something about the monsters. Same. When Ovid wrote his Metamorphoses, look at the title, Metamorphose. Sometimes gods and humans, they transform themselves into monsters. They transform themselves into creatures, brutal creatures. So they metamorphose into something else, either because of a curse or they want to achieve something by changing their form, right? They become shapeshifters. Okay, so now the Sphinx is a monster. Now, many psychologists believe these monsters are nothing but the fierce imagination of human mind, our fears. Say, when human beings talked about dragons, say, whether dragons existed or not, we do not know. Whether a monster like Godzilla existed or not, we do not know. Any of those creatures which are shown on films as monsters, they are all creations of human mind. Perhaps they had existed long, long, long ago, millions and millions of years back. But we try to give shape to our imagination, and it is all our chimera, that is, they have their origins in human mind. Okay, so now look at this Sphinx, a dreadful monster, and this monster kills and devours all travelers who cannot answer the riddle that she puts to them. So, how does the riddle go? It goes like this. What walks on four legs in the morning and two legs at noon and on three legs in the evening? Well, the answer is a human being, because we all know, and during our infancy, we all crawl on all fours. Then, during our adulthood, we walk upright on two legs. And by the time we reach our old age, we lean on a cane. We need the support of a cane or a walking stick. So, Oedipus solves a riddle, and the Sphinx kills herself. Then, the people of Thebes, they are grateful to Oedipus for ridding them of the Sphinx. And the Thebans reward Oedipus by making him their king, and they give their queen Jocasta as his wife. Right, he doesn't know Jocasta is his own mother. So for many years, the couple live happily, and they have three children. And as a result of this incest, a terrible plague descends on the land. Again, people get killed in large numbers because of the plague. And the oracle proclaims, saying that Laius' murder must be punished. And soon, Oedipus discovers that he had unwittingly killed his own father, and he had married his own mother. The moment the truth is out, when Oedipus realizes that she is dead and all the children are accursed, he perhaps takes her He gouges out his eyes and he relinquishes his throne. So, finally, he is banished from Thebes, and accompanied by his daughter Antigone, he goes round and round. Finally, he arrives at Colonus, a shrine near Athens, where he dies. So that's how the story of Oedipus break from this stories. There are many other stories, branching of tales. There are many other myths. So chief among them is Orpheus and Eurydice. Now, Orpheus and Eurydice, you know this story. This is a story of a poet and musician. Many poets, including Milton. See, Milton makes a reference to Orpheus and Eurydice in his El Allegro and Il Penseroso. El Allegro and Il Penseroso, they both are companion poems. You have to read these poems, where Milton makes a reference to most of these mythemes. M-Y-T-H-E-M-E-S. Mythemes are small units of a myth. So, he makes use of them. He alludes to all these myths. In the last lecture, I told you about the allusionary effect of myths. Now, what is this allusionary effect? Every writer of the Renaissance thought that they should quote some Greco-Roman mythical figure in their work of art. And somehow they believe it would enrich their work because they had alluded. It was one way of showing off their knowledge of ancient Greece and Rome. Ancient Greece and Rome. And this was one way of showing off their knowledge of Latin and Greek. So, they alluded to most of these mythical figures in the literary work. Chief among them was Orpheus and Eurydice. And you know the story of Orpheus and Eurydice. Orpheus is a poet, he's a human, right? And he was given the lyre by Apollo. He became an excellent musician. His music, and he had, for his music, he had no rival among the mortals. So when he played and sang, he even animated the inanimate things. Even the rocks and trees responded, and even the untamed beasts, the wild animals, they responded to his music. And according to this myth, wherever he walked, even the rivers turned their course to follow him. So, suppose he would choose to walk through the city of Trichinopoly, means River Kaveri would follow him wherever he went, because his music was so enchanting. His music was enchanting not only to humans but also to other members of the natural world. So now he loved his wife, this lovely nymph Eurydice. Now soon after the wedding, the bride was stung by a viper, a snake, and Eurydice died. So he was overwhelmed with grief, and he was determined to go even to the gates of the underworld and try to bring Eurydice back. So at the entrance of the gates, right, the underworld, Hades saw him. That was, Hades was the ruler of the underworld. You remember? A brother of Zeus. He was the ruler of the underworld. He was so moved by the plight of Orpheus, and he agreed to allow Eurydice to return to the natural world, but on one condition. That is, Orpheus should not turn back till they reach the natural world, till they saw the light of day. But Orpheus loved Eurydice so much. He wanted to say whether his wife was following him. But when he turned, without heeding to the forewarning of Tales, Eurydice vanished. So she was taken back to the underworld. Then Orpheus, he avoided human company and he played music in the wilds, playing for the rocks and trees and rivers. And finally, a group of Thracian women from the Greek town of Thrace. They were followers of the god of Dionysus, that is Bacchus, all drunken people. They followed him and they killed this gentle musician. And his severed head was thrown in the river Hebrus, and even then he continued to call for his wife Eurydice. And finally, he was carried to the shore of Lesbos by the Muses, and they buried him there. And Orpheus, after his death, his lyre, on which he played music, it became the constellation Lyra. Right? So all the heavenly bodies are given the names of the Greek mythical figures. Go and find out how this name Milky Way came about. It's an interesting, I'm not going to tell the story of Milky Way. How it came from the milk of their goddess, and that's why it is called Milky Way. Go and find out and go and search Renaissance painting. Renaissance painting of Greek mythology, you would learn more about the Greek mythology. Okay, now look at this. Another popular myth is that of Endymion. Now, Endymion in Greek mythology, he was a youth of exceptional beauty. Remember, John Keats, he wrote this beautiful poem where this famous line occurs. The thing of beauty is the joy for ever, right? And you go and read Endymion, and John Keats made use of most of these Greek myths. So now, according to this account, he was a shepherd and he lived on Mount Latmos in Caria, and Selene, the goddess of the moon, she is also known as Cynthia, she fell in love with him and visited him every night, and he lay asleep in a cave. She bore him 50 daughters. She did not, because she knew the beauty of Endymion. He was so handsome and beautiful. She thought either the goddesses or these mortal women, they would steal him away from her. So she put him to sleep forever. And he remained young. Right? So he remained forever young. And he fathered 50 daughters. So he was always in a sleeping state. So, and this is the story of Endymion. And there is another version to this story. And in that version, God Zeus offered him anything he desired. And Endymion chose an everlasting sleep in which he might remain forever young. And in another version of the story, this perpetual sleep was a punishment inflicted by Zeus for having dared to fall in love with Zeus' consort Hera. Right? So, story of Endymion. Now, go and read John Keats. He also makes allusions to many of these Greek mythologies in every poem of his, even in his ode to Psyche. That is, Psyche is another figure from Greek mythology. And John Keats wrote Lamia, the snake woman, who is a half snake and a half woman, right? And she is an enchantress. So how she enchants Menippus Lysias, you know the story, Menippus Lysias, how she enchants him. Unfortunately, Apollonius, he happens to attend the marriage, and he finds out who this Lamia is, and in spite of her begging, he discloses her identity. Shrieking, she leaves the place. That's her story. Okay, so now all these stories, I'll end with this story, the story of Pygmalion, another Greek mythology, Roman mythology. In this, the sculptor of Cyprus, Pygmalion, he hated women and he was resolved not to marry. But he makes this most beautiful sculpture, the sculpture of a beautiful, the statue of a beautiful woman. And he falls madly in love with this figure. But this figure is a lifeless figure, right? So, but he loves this figure, his own creation. So he prays to Aphrodite or Venus, goddess of love. So, and Venus gives life to this figure. See, yesterday I watched on TV a businessman from Karnataka who had two daughters. He had lost his wife. He wanted a wax figure of his wife to be made. It was a very moving scene which I saw on TV. A lifelike statue, a lifelike figure of this business person. And this was a family function. And this statue was kept, this wax figure was kept next to their father, and the two daughters, they were also there, and they all had the satisfaction of standing next to their beloved mom, who is no more. Okay, see, now such things, such stories repeat themselves in human lives. When George Bernard Shaw wrote his Pygmalion, you know the story of the professor of phonetics, Professor Higgins, and you know the story how he falls in love with his own creation. So an interesting story, and in all these stories you come across characters. So characters from mythologies, now they have a way of coming back. They somehow or other, these stories come back into our lives. So when these stories come back in some form or other, either in the form of literature or in the form of a song or even in real life, as I told you yesterday, how a businessman created the statue of his own wife. We try to replicate these stories. See? Take for the story of hero and heroine, the story of Rama and Sita. Now, Rama is one woman man. Sita is a very devoted wife. She is the wife of this man, Rama, and she chooses to follow him even to the forest or into the deep jungle. That is a villain. Look at all the Indian films, all the thousands and hundreds and thousands of films, the same story is repeated. And film after film after film after film, that is this hero. He is devoted to only this girl. And that is this heroine. She is devoted only to this man. There is always a villain, right? Who kidnaps her, who takes her away. And the hero goes and rescues her, right? See, this is what Carl Jung talks about in his analytical psychology. Go and read, he talks about hero, heroine, anima, animus, and so on. You go and read Carl Jung. Same story is repeated, film after film after film after film. We never get tired of this, watching this. That's how they all become cultural archetypes. So these mythological figures, they become cultural archetypes. And culture-specific archetypes, they are not universal. Now, mark the words of Roland Barthes. They are specific to a time. They are specific to a place. They are not universal. So for the Greeks, these characters were specific. Look at all the islands and the names of cities in Greeks. They are in Greece. They are named after these characters. Not only that, they chose to name all the celestial figures. For example, the names of the planets, the names of the galaxies, and the names of the stars. They are all named after this Greco-Roman mythological figures. So that's how myths play a very important role in our culture. So as you read mythology, read it carefully. You have to read it with understanding and what each myth tells us about. So as Frederick Jameson says elsewhere, he talks of signatures of the visible. This is a work written by Frederick Jameson somewhere around 1992. So, in which he says, this modern day literature or modern day films, they are nothing but symbolic solutions to real problems. And they are symbolic solutions and they are nothing but a replication of our myths. So now myths have these two important characteristics, or the most important characteristic of a myth is, the myths are timeless. Remember, the myths are timeless, or they are simultaneously historical and ahistorical. They are timeless. They are simultaneously historical and ahistorical. You can never arrive at a point in time and say with conviction, this happened in this particular century, this particular era. No. So they have this timeless quality about them. And the second one is, the second important characteristic is, they belong. Yeah, I stand corrected. I was telling you about the yesterday's figure. It was made out of silicon, not out of wax. Okay. I thought it was wax. It wasn't wax. I remember reading it. Thanks a lot. It was made. That figure was made using silicon. Fine. Right. Now, look at this. These myths have a place. They happen in a place. Right. I told you in my first lecture, when you go and explore the stories of gods, goddesses, demiurges, right, or even what we call tonic deities, C-H-T-H-O-N-I-C, tonic deities. They all have a story. We call that Stala Puranam. It belongs to a place. Sometimes Pulan, they say, Pulan Puranam or something like that. They use a modern word. That is, Stala Puranam means the place, the story of a place. The goddess or gods have a place. So you need to understand this. Okay. So this is this quality about myths. These are the two distinct qualities about myths, and you have to keep them at the back of your mind. And myths have a way of creeping into our everyday conversation as they creep into our literature, as they somehow or other burrow into our psyche itself. That is why Carl Jung actually calls that as part of our racial memory. Part of our racial memory. See, in the case of the West, somehow or other, Christianity tried to supplant the Greek mythology. So when Christianity came, it brought with itself new stories of creation, new stories of saints, and new stories of what they call patriarchs. Sometimes you find some similarities between the Greek mythology and the Christian stories or the Judeo-Christian-Islamic stories. Okay, so the place of the patriarch, for instance, that is how the father god who controls everything, Zeus controls everything in that Greek mythology, right? And in this modern day religions, especially religions which have their origin in the Middle East, namely Christianity, Islam, and Judaism, they have their own theogony, they have their own cosmogony, how the world originated, how God created. So this is utterly different from the Greek mythology, right? So try to understand the world. The world has always been already there. That is according to Hindu mythology. And you go to even small communities like the Bororos in the Amazon, or people in Vanuatu Island, in remote Pacific islands, they have their own myths. You go to the Aborigines in Australia, or you go to the Maoris in New Zealand. They have their own stories, how the world came about, how their lives came about. And it will make an interesting study to compare one myth with another. And finally, you come to this understanding, that is, this world did not form on its own. It was created by someone. It was created by some invisible force. So now that's how all these creation stories end. So each people group or each cultural group, they have their own stories. Each group has its own story, and it makes an interesting read. When you read literature from different parts of the world, these stories have a way of coming back to us. And they may not control our lives, but they certainly influence our minds, because they are alive and they exist through the language that we speak. The language itself inherits this story. And there is no distinction that the mythos and the logos, they are some or other related to each other, and one is not distinct from the other. Okay, thank you for your patient listening. And with that, we come to the end of the second part of literature and mythology. If you really want to visit to know about these lectures, you go and visit our Department of English, Faculty of English, National College, and the lectures are there for you to watch, and I think you can download also. Faculty of English, National College, you can go. If you miss my lecture, and I request you to join me before 3:10, because I'm not good at multitasking. I play the host. Okay, so